Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Lauren Gawne.
And I'm Gretchen McCulloch. And today we're getting enthusiastic about how policies affect language. But first, we had an online live show.
Thanks to patrons who attended our live show Q&A on the Lingthusiasm Discord.
It was so much fun to get to talk about swearing with you, hear some of your favorite swear words in various languages, and more. This episode will also be available as our May bonus episode on Patreon if you want to listen to a slightly more edited version.
And our most recent bonus episode was an interview with Nicole Holliday and Ben Zimmer of Spectacular Vernacular, where we talked about linguistics and language games.
It was so much fun to get to talk to Ben and Nicole about their favorite word games, some things about Wordle and other games, and play a live word game on air.
So I've been thinking about the Rosetta Stone lately.
Okay. Are you planning on starting a new career as an Egyptologist?
No, it's just a very interesting artifact because of the languages that it's written in. So it has three languages on this big stone slab. Up the top, you have Egyptian hieroglyphs, and then you have a language called Demotic, which is a more alphabetic form of the same language that the hieroglyphs were in. And then down the bottom, you have Greek.
The Rosetta Stone is famous, right, because it has these two different versions of the same language, and this is what enabled more recent researchers to crack what the hieroglyphs actually stood for and realize that these symbols that look like, you know, birds and people and baskets and stuff like that actually stand for sounds in most cases, and figure out how to read all of the other hieroglyphic inscriptions.
But it's also a really interesting symbolic document because the choice of these three languages tell us a lot about what young King Ptolemy V was dealing with in terms of the politics of the country when he created the Rosetta Stone and other announcement tablets like this.
Oh, that's right. I mean, it was useful for scholars later, but King Ptolemy V wasn't thinking, I'm going to make this document that's going to be super useful for scholars later to decipher this writing system that they don't know. Why was he making this trialphabetic bilingual document?
The Greek down the bottom was the language that his government used. So that was kind of his usefulness, having the announcement in Greek. But he also needed the locals to be able to read the text. So that's why it's in Demotic. And then the Egyptian hieroglyphs are there because that was the language of the gods. And he wanted to impress upon people that he had the willingness of the Egyptian priests, the fact that this announcement came out of Memphis, which is where the priests were, not Alexandria, where he was ruling from, really shows just how much this is a political document and that the choice of these languages was part of the policy of language that he had to keep everyone as happy as possible about his rule.
And so if you're like an average Egyptian person at the time, you aren't necessarily literate in hieroglyphs yourself, but you're sort of used to seeing them around in official inscriptions. And so him putting hieroglyphs on this stone is like, don't worry, guys, I'm still doing the official thing. I'm still ruling the right way by doing the way that sort of respects the traditions of antiquity that you're used to seeing.
But I'm also modern and I'm Greek at the same time.
Right.
He's doing all of this in a single announcement document.
And he's not overtly saying any of this, but it's by putting it in all three languages that it effectively says this.
Yes, the choices that a government makes about what languages it uses says a lot about that government's policy towards the linguistic environment that it's in.
It's really interesting that in our day and age, the Rosetta Stone is this symbol of sort of translation or of the key to deciphering or understanding something. But it also starts out as a document that's also got this sort of symbolic nature. It's just that what it symbolizes is quite different at the time.
Absolutely. And it's a really good reminder that the choice of language that gets made in public spaces says a lot about the policy of a government of the day.
Yeah, and it says, you know, who has power, who has access to power, and which types of groups a government or policymaking body is trying to recognize. I feel like I was sensitive to this at a young age because I was sort of sitting there at breakfast, like reading the back of the milk carton or reading the back of the cereal box and seeing all of the bilingual labeling in English and French, which is very much a Canadian political choice to say, if you're going to make a packaged goods, it needs to say all of the information on it in both of the two official languages of the Canadian government. And I ended up sort of learning words like carbohydrate or oats or something in French at this fairly early age because they're right there on the cereal box and you know, might as well just sort of pick them up as you're reading things. But it is also this sort of very state-sponsored and nation-building form of kind of bilingualism as policy.
And that's quite a depth of bilingualism. Like, I was surprised when I went to Canada. It really is the entire ingredients list and the manufacturer's details are presented in both languages. It's not just the kind of main name of the product. It really is full and comprehensive public bilingual signage. I compare that to a community service center that I used to access that had this wonderful wall when you walked mm-hmm. in where it said welcome in all of these different languages. And we used to entertain ourselves by figuring out how many of them we knew. But once you accessed the service, you were really given the choice to only access the service in English. And this kind of very superficial, like decorative multilingualism that existed on the wall but didn't exist in any of the ways that you interacted with the service is a very different approach.
I mean, I would say that we have those, you know, 20 language signs that are just as decorative in Canada. That does not mean you actually get to talk to somebody in all 20 of those. And especially, you know, hilariously, when those signs contain typos and have like Arabic script that doesn't render properly because the left to right encoding and the right to left encoding aren't matching in the graphics program that someone was using, which is really underlines the very performative nature of language as decoration in a public space rather than actually trying to be language as communicative, because they clearly had no one who even knew anything about, say, Arabic or Persian looking at this sign and saying, hey, this script is not displaying correctly.
And I think that underlines the importance of not just having things in language, but having things be about language as well, and actually having the support for people to access community services in a language that works for them, as well as having stuff decoratively in language.
Yeah, and it's interesting because, you know, there's an aspect to which having French on the signs definitely raised the perceived value of French in my childhood and sort of, you know, stay in French class, kids, because it'll help you get a job later. If you want to get a job with the government, there is this sort of performative aspect to making language supported by policy. But then that has to be backed up by commitment to the actual people who live and use that language, and not just sort of the, okay, we're going to stick it on a sign for aesthetic value, but clearly there's nobody here who actually knows whether this language is backwards or not. I mean, literally physically backwards, not some sort of slur.
And I think there are times where just having the visibility of language at all is a really powerful policy statement. So in my home state of Victoria in Australia, over the last few years, there's been a handful of really important environment bills that have gone through the state government that have included a preface or part of the law in one of the local Indigenous languages. So the 2017 Yarra River Protection Act, that's the river that flows right through the capital city of Victoria, Melbourne, is in English, but it has a preface in the Woiwurrung language, which is the language of the Wurundjeri people whose land Melbourne is situated on. And the title of the bill is also given in Woiwurrung in that document. And it's really exciting to see Victorian languages be visible in this way when they haven't been for over a century in this state.
But it's an interesting tension, right? Because there's making the law in the language, but if the law itself isn't favorable to the Indigenous people in the area, then it's still a sort of decoration.
And it also underscores the need to continue to support Woiwurrung speaking people to continue to develop this language. This is a language going through revitalization. It hasn't been actively spoken for 50 years. So again, it's not just in language. It has to be about language and supporting language as well. But sometimes these symbolic steps are also really important on that revitalization journey.
And there's also sort of a practical benefit to governments mandating that something be in a particular language, because it literally sometimes raises the economic value of a language. You know, I was told stay in French class. If you ever want to get a job with the government, you need to speak French. And here you have some Woiwurrung translators being hired to make this text, or some, you know, writers hired to compose this text mm-hmm. in this a way that also provides languages with certain kinds of economic value.
Absolutely. And we didn't have the same incentive learning languages in Australia. Funnily enough, Australia doesn't even have an official national language, much like the United States of America. And so sometimes you don't even need an official policy when everything is presented in a single language and you're not given that multilingual option that creates the policy environment instead.
So you don't necessarily need an official policy, because if you actually look at the laws, they're all written in English, except for a few that in more recent years have had these preambles or these additions in local Indigenous languages.
Mm-hmm.
There's an interesting sort of version of that that plays out with Canada's history of bilingualism. So the current Governor General of Canada, which is the, you know, representative of the Queen in the constitutional monarchy sense, and her name is Mary Simon, and she is the first holder of this office to speak an Indigenous language. She's bilingual with Inuktitut and English.
Great.
And she's an Inuktitut woman herself. But some people have gotten upset in Canada because she's quote unquote not bilingual.
She's the wrong kind of bilingual.
In the official Canadian policy sense, where official state-sponsored bilingualism is English and French. And she's made great pains to point out that she started learning French since she started holding office, and that she respects the French and so on and so forth, because this is this sort of political football. But the bilingualisms that get sponsored by a nation state also sometimes make this sort of vacuum where other languages that are spoken in or that are being revitalized in a particular nation don't necessarily get the same level of support.
And I guess this wasn't a problem for Mary Simon before she became the Governor General, when she was just a citizen, because Canada has a policy as a country of being bilingual on the assumption that private citizens can operate in English or French as suits them. But as soon as she steps into this official role, she's speaking for the country, and the country seems to expect her to speak in the two official languages.
Right. And there's a lot of levels at which this policy makes sense. You know, if you want to have someone who is being a judge or who's being an elected representative or being, you know, higher levels of civil servant, there's this expectation that, you know, speaking both English and French is going to really help out with that career. And it sort of depends on the political party, depends on the particular type of job, but that's the perception there. But also, there are many people in Canada who speak various languages, whether they're Indigenous languages or immigrant languages, that aren't part of the official notion of bilingualism. And shouldn't they also have representatives in government? Like, that's the sort of question that, you know, having these two particular colonial languages as the official government languages raises.
Especially because, and we always need to point out, there is nothing inherently better about English or French as languages.
Exactly.
Or any major language that's used by a nation state as their official language.
This is one of those things that really gets me about, like, it's fun to be excited about language. It's fun to enjoy your own language or enjoy languages that you're learning. But sometimes you get this sort of pernicious view that, oh, like, English took over as a world language because it was so good at adopting words from other languages. We've got this flexible vocabulary. Like, English became a dominant language not because of, like, verbs and nouns, but because of guns and money and other elements of power that were wielded by people who happened to bring their English along with them.
And I think it's always worth remembering who the policymakers get to be and who gets to set the policy agenda. And you see it play out time and time again, that there are particular types of power that are interestingly kind of scalar. So if we look at somewhere like Japan in the Meiji period, there was a reform to standardize Japanese. And funnily enough, the variety they chose to standardize to was Tokyo Japanese, which just happened to be where the Meiji government ruled from.
Oh, so surprised.
And so there was active reform to standardize Japanese in places like the Ryukyuan Islands, in like the province of Okinawa, for example. But these languages are so different to standard Japanese that it was a major language shift for people in this area.
The analogy that I have seen is that Tokyo Japanese compared to Okinawan, which is a Ryukyuan language, is more different than English to German in terms of comprehensibility. So there's really quite a lot of difference there. They're related, but there's quite a lot of difference.
Over the last few decades, there's been this acknowledgement of the uniqueness and the importance of Ryukyuan languages and a kind of return to awareness of their local heritage. But what's really interesting is that Okinawan, as the largest of these varieties, has so much more visibility than some of the others. So there are like at least half a dozen or so Ryukyuan languages, and Okinawan is the one people have usually heard of.
Oh, right. So it's sort of, it goes all the way down, like it's fractal. There's one major language in the country, and then even within the more minoritized languages, there's one of those that takes up more of the oxygen, and that the languages sort of crowding out space from each other goes all the way down.
And look, I'm sure within Miyako or Amami, there's also discussions and debates about how to move forward with language planning and language policy. It's kind of policy choices and power discussions all the way down.
And this, you know, picking the language of the capital that it just so happens people with power speak, you know, this is the same thing with the French of Paris or the English of London. Like, there's lots of levels at which this type of thing happens in different places where it's not an accident that the language or the dialect or the variety that's spoken by the people who already have that kind of power gets picked to be the one that's taught in schools or the one that's used for national level media or the one that's promoted at the expense of other ones.
And sometimes the choice ends up being to pick something that's outside of the traditional power imbalances. So you see in both South Africa and India, English plays a really central role in national language and in communication because it's kind of avoiding picking something that's more locally politically contentious. So in India, that's Hindi. A lot of the other areas don't like the idea that one of the major languages would be the official language of the whole country.
Mm-hmm.
And so they've defaulted to English.
Or in South Africa, rather than picking between Afrikaans or Zulu or Xhosa or any of their other languages, saying, okay, what if we picked a power from this sort of foreign hegemon that's left now, then we will avoid privileging one of these groups over each other.
Yeah.
And the historic traces of sometimes you pick a non-local hegemonic power just to avoid choosing between individual local groups can be surprisingly long. So when I was joining the European Linguistics Society, I was interested to see that the official name for it is the Societas Linguistica Europaea, which is, of course, in Latin.
Of course, you say, as though that's obvious, but of course it's in Latin.
And the of course is because also if you're in Europe and you're saying, oh, you know, which of these European languages shall we pick between? One way of saying we don't want to make this choice is say, what if we use a language of a, you know, an antique local hegemon that, you know, is none of our country's current language?
And was a language of international trade and education for many centuries.
Yeah.
Which allows you to sidestep resorting to one of the national languages of Europe when a lot of these languages have complex historical legacies. And part of that is because often the idea of a nation is imposing an artificial geographic boundary around languages.
Is this where we bring up the classic quote, language is a dialect with an army and a navy?
Absolutely have to discuss this because the creation of nations really did shape the way people thought about languages and standards and the choice of languages that you use to govern that created nation.
Yeah, so sometimes when linguists are trying to figure out, you know, are these two things that people use in a particular area, are they languages, are they dialects of each other? One criteria that's sometimes used is, do speakers who speak one understand the other? Do signers who sign one understand the other? So this is like our example of, you know, Japanese and Okinawan are as difficult to understand mutually for each other, a bit harder than between English and German. And if you're an English speaker who's encountered German or vice versa, you say, oh, yeah, I don't immediately understand what's going on in that language. But sometimes this diagnostic criteria can lead us to directions that aren't supported by what people actually do in a practical sense, because that's a power relationship. So, you know, Norwegian and Swedish people can often understand each other, but those languages get called separate languages because they're each associated with a nation state.
And then on the other side of things, you have a nation state like China, where you have these mutually unintelligible varieties that get called dialects of Chinese because China wants to create this sense of unified language policy. So nations have an interesting effect on how people think about the relationship between languages and dialects.
And sometimes something can be called a dialect to sort of make it seem less like it should be taken seriously, because dialect gets interpreted as a pejorative. Like, there's a linguist sense in which it's just a word for any variety. But then in practice, when you get told, oh, you're just a dialect, that seems like a pejorative. So there was a campaign a number of years ago in Guatemala about the various local indigenous languages, which are generally belong to the Mayan language family. And sometimes they got all sort of grouped together as just Maya and all dialects of Maya when they have individual names. You know, you have Kakchikel and Quiche, Kanhobal, and various others. And the educational campaign was no son dialectos, son idiomas. They're not dialects, they're languages, because they're not mutually intelligible with each other. And there are several of them, and they're not just sort of fungible for each other. If you have someone who speaks one, that doesn't mean they can interpret for someone who speaks something else.
Interesting how they're trying to change the discourse around what has been a long-held policy around those languages in Guatemala.
And I think it's, we have a lot of these sort of projects of multinationalism or, you know, colonial empires and sort of things where you're trying to replace or suppress particular languages. But there are examples of places that have had ongoing, stable community multilingualism or small languages spoken in a variety of areas as well.
In fact, if we look at human history, stable, small-scale community multilingualism is absolutely the norm, and nation states with their official languages are like a weird aberration. So, for example, in the north of Australia, in the Northern Territory, you had a long-held tradition, and even kind of the oral history of how these languages came to be was that they were all placed in their own country, and then if you were born into a language, you had ownership of that language. And as you grew up and interacted with more communities in the area, you would gain the ability to speak those languages and interact with people in those communities. But it's different to have a language that is yours and that you speak compared to a language that you speak because it belongs to someone else. And that's a model of language ownership and language use that still is pervasive in Australian Indigenous languages, especially up in the Northern Territory, where the languages that are still being passed on to children are mostly spoken today. You see, for example, someone who is a Waijin, they are an Awaija speaker and they own that language, but over their lifetime they might come to speak Hmong or Gunjegmi and have social relationships or family relationships into those languages and communities as well.
And sometimes stable small community multilingualism is supported by other types of what you could think of as cultural policies. Mm-hmm. So one of these cultural policies is the practice of exogamy, which means that when you marry someone, you need to marry someone who's outside of your social group or outside of your linguistic group. And that means that effectively every household potentially has multiple languages going on. And of course, if you want to talk to your partner, you are end up being functionally bilingual. Your kids end up growing up bilingual because you were also a product of exogamy. So you probably had parents who spoke multiple languages, even though one of the ones became the one that you officially identified with for, you know, marriage purposes. And so this idea of having like a pluricentric norm where everyone's being exposed to multiple languages and raised in multilingual environments and marrying multilingually is a very different way from how I'm used to approaching how does a group of people decide on which language to speak.
Yeah, it's a very different social policy environment. And part of the reason Australia's Indigenous language communities have suffered so much is because of some actively bad policies that affected directly the speakers of those languages, and therefore by extension the languages themselves. You had children removed from families, you had active discouragement of speaking languages. I know very similar things happened in the residential school system in Canada.
Yep.
And after so many years of such actively bad language policies, we really haven't picked up the ball in terms of working on sustained, proactively better policies around these communities and their languages.
Yeah, and to go back to, you know, the Mary Simon example, Canada is still funding, for example, French education in Nunavut to a higher level per capita than it's funding Inuktitut education in Nunavut, even though that's actually the language that's of the population in that area. And even just funding Indigenous languages at an equitable level with how it's funding English and French, let alone maybe even funding them at a higher level because of the active language suppression that the Canadian government was doing for so many years, that you'd think they could maybe try to do the inverse, but we're not even at that level of parity yet.
Be really great to see more countries proactively using language policy to address some of the bad choices that have been made.
And, you know, in some ways, Quebec gets cited as an example within Canada in other language revitalization contexts of various sorts of legal policies, whether that's signage policies that have to include French or education policies where kids have to go to school in French, as an example of successfully making a language, you know, increasingly important or validating a language that people were using but didn't have the sort of state level validation. But it's one of those things where, okay, this can be a model, but like, where else are we doing this and where else do we need to be doing this?
Mm-hmm.
I've been thinking about this question of language policy and how the personal sort of interacts with the policy level a lot recently, because I've been reading this new book by Julie Sedivy, who's a linguist, called Memory Speaks.
Excellent.
And I am familiar with Julie from linguist Twitter, and I was really delighted to find that her book is very good. And it's sort of a combination of memoir and science book. So,
oh, what a fabulous genre combination.
I know. It interweaves things about her life and other people who've had heritage language or bilingualism experiences, and then also with things about what the psycholinguistics literature, so she's trained as a psycholinguist, what it says about language learning and language reclamation. So there's this combination of anecdotes and studies that makes it really readable.
Fabulous. What were some highlights for you?
So the basic premise of the book is that Julie Sedivy and her family immigrated from what was then Czechoslovakia to Canada when Julie was 4 years old. Obviously, her parents were the ones sort of doing this immigration.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, they brought along their four-year-old, as you would expect. And then she didn't go back there until adulthood.
Right.
And so, you know, she was speaking Czech as a kid, and then she gradually sort of switched to English through school, and English became dominant. And then she has this voyage of sort of reclaiming Czech in adulthood when she goes back there and interacts with some of her extended family again.
This story of moving from speaking a heritage language as a migrant through to feeling that implications of policy and that pressure to move to the language of the country that you are living in is such a common story, where the focus is on not necessarily retaining that multilingual experience, but especially for kids, trying to fit into the education system is such a big pressure for them.
Right, exactly. And I think that's one of the things that Sedivy does a really good job of in the book, because she's talking about her own personal experience, but then she's also interweaving other people's stories from memoirs and from talking to people, and like people write into her now that she's writing about it a bit and talking about that, and talking about it both as an immigrant experience, because this is so common as a part of immigration, and also as an Indigenous experience where there's similar pressures from language shift, but without that sort of comforting buttress of the home country where like she could always go back and find 10 million Czech speakers, even if currently the trip across was closed to her in the 90s when there was political turmoil going on. You don't have that sort of backstop of comfort if you're worried about losing a heritage language and all of the speakers of that language are still in Canada and there aren't very many of them.
Her story sounds slightly unusual, though, in that she gave herself the chance to reconnect with a heritage language, which not everyone gets the opportunity to do.
Yeah. So she has this anecdote that sticks out to me, that she goes back and she's in Prague in the train station, and she overhears this announcement on the loudspeaker in Czech, you know, this is when the next train's arriving.
Mm-hmm.
And she says, "I felt as if one of my brothers or uncles had, as a prank, grabbed the microphone and started speaking in our own family code." I expected the announcer to be pulled away at any moment by someone with real authority. Of course, in my mind, I was well aware that train announcements in Prague would be made in Czech, but standing on that railway platform, what I felt in the goosebumps that prickled my skin was, by God, there's a whole nation full of people who speak this language.
It really shows the power of seeing your language used in a public space, and policy that encourages a particular language in public is very different to private household usage.
Right, exactly. It's sort of public-private dichotomy again of this language is on the milk cartons or this language is being spoken in the train station.
There must have been a real sense of nostalgia involved in returning to Czechia and engaging with her family's heritage.
Yeah, she also has a really great anecdote about that, and she links it to this notion of, you know, having the childhood food that tastes like nostalgia to you and that comes with all of the emotional baggage around this food that your parents used to make or that you used to eat for a treat as a kid or that you really enjoyed there, and someone else having that favorite childhood food when you're grown up and you're like waxing rhapsodic about, oh yeah, it's so great. And somebody else tastes it and they're like, Yeah, I mean, this is fine, it's delicious, but they don't have all of those emotional sense memories that come back when they're eating that food that you have years and decades of associations with.
Reminds me of the experience of feeding people who didn't grow up with Commonwealth country Christmases, Christmas pudding, and they're like, this is not as good as the stories made it sound.
I think, you know, when I tried Turkish Delight, I was expecting it to be much more exciting, that the Chronicles of Narnia made it sound like it was going to be really exciting. And then I was like, oh, okay. I clearly don't have whatever memories C.S. Lewis has of this food. And I think that, you know, having this association of like, this was the language that, you know, as she says, somebody stroked your hair while singing a lullaby to you, or this is a language that someone scolded you in, or this is a language that is associated with these very bright and visceral memories of childhood, compared to a language that you learned a little bit older and is maybe more intellectual or less immediate, or is associated with sort of a different emotional tenor. And she goes into some of the research on what happens with different types of people going to therapy in their first language versus a second language. How does that experience change? It's a really interesting combination of sort of the personal and the broader scale studies.
Being able to access therapy or medical services in a language you feel most comfortable in highlights just how much personal effect policy can have on your life and your experiences.
Right. Language is very personal, but it isn't only personal because it's existing in a society that supports it or denies it or something like that. Anyway, everyone should read Memory Speaks. I think it's very interesting. and I learned a lot of things.
People's connection to their language is seen again and again in the way that people fight for particular policies. So the way that Canada made sure as it became a nation that it was supporting both the French-speaking populations and the English-speaking populations that were there by the time it became a country.
And explicitly not to the Indigenous populations. Mm-hmm, but indeed. Yep, that was what was going on at the time.
There are many other stories as well. When India was partitioned into India and what was then Pakistan, both West Pakistan, today's Pakistan, and East Pakistan, which is today's Bangladesh, a lot of that division was done on some language grounds. But the East Pakistan area had the language of Urdu imposed on it, which was not a language of that area. And after that happened, the Bangla-speaking population protested that Urdu would be the one and only official language of this new state of Pakistan. And there were a series of sustained protests in 1947. That carried through for many years. And this led to a major protest in 1952 that was led by students of the University of Dhaka. And during that protest, that was all around the need to recognize Bangla as a language of Pakistan, the police opened fire and killed five and injured hundreds of the protesters that were there. And eventually, after this event, and after much more public agitation, Bangla was recognized as a language of Pakistan and became the language of the country of Bangladesh when it became its own country. And Mother Language Day is actually recognized as a public holiday in Bangladesh because of this event.
And then on the 50th anniversary of this, it became International Mother Language Day, which was recognized by the United Nations on February 21st every year as a way of celebrating and bringing awareness towards linguistic and cultural diversity. So they have a theme every year, and a lot of organizations, you know, museums and so on, use it as kind of an excuse to show movies about people, you know, agitating for their own languages or other types of programming, bringing in speakers, and provide sort of a focal point for programming that's related to the notions of mother languages, and in particularly in this context, mother languages that are otherwise sometimes minoritized or not necessarily given as much attention to.
And those that are actively oppressed. One thing I find really interesting about International Mother Language Day, because it's run by the UN, the UN sits outside of the usual national level discussion, and so language advocates from different countries can kind of come together and kind of get around the national level policy and limitations of discussion and connect with advocates from other parts of the world.
And I think that's one of the things about language policy in general, is that there's often simultaneously this very personal aspect of a language that was taken from somebody, or language that was, you know, not passed down in a particular family, that is both very personal, but also something that has happened a lot in a lot of different circumstances around the world. And sometimes bringing language communities and language advocates together to learn from each other and talk to each other and get this sense of, you know, swapping tips for ways to bring that language back into more common use, or ways to encourage each other in language advocacy, is the kind of thing that a big international organization like the UN can do.
And in recognition of the fact that so many Indigenous languages have suffered from power imbalances and policies that have directly and negatively affected them, the UN has declared this decade the decade of Indigenous languages from this year, 2022, all the way through to 2032.
So hopefully that will provide a good focal point for discussions around various things that people are doing to support Indigenous languages. And we'll see how that plays out between 2022 and 2032.
It can be really easy to stick hello in a bunch of different languages on the wall, and you might even get the writing systems going in the right direction. But policy involves hard and sustained work. But when you see the positive effect it has on people and society, I feel like it's definitely worth thinking about how we can do that hard work.
Yeah, I think the things that let people bring their full self into society at large rather than holding it away from the public sphere because they feel like parts of them aren't welcome is this big thing that's a huge benefit.
This was really one of those episodes where we had so many stories we could tell. Everyone is affected by language policy, and language policies in different parts of the world play out in sometimes really different and sometimes alarmingly similar ways.
So if you have another language policy story that you want to share with us or with your fellow lingthusiasts, do let us know, tag us in it on social media, or let us know on the Lingthusiasm Discord, because it's one of those topics that, you know, someone could run a whole podcast that was entirely about language policy. For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts. And you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA scarves, not judging your grammar, just acquiring it, onesies, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I can be found as at Gretchen A. McSee on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com. And my book about internet language is called Because Internet.
I tweet and blog as Superlinguo. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to extra Lingthusiasm episodes to listen to every month, plus our entire archive of bonus episodes to listen to right now at patreon.com/lingthusiasm, or follow the links from our website. Have you gotten really into linguistics and you wish you had more people to talk with about it? Patrons can get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans, plus all patrons help keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include text encoding, how people pick linguistic research topics, and an interview with Ben Zimmer and Nicole Holliday of Spectacular Vernacular. Can't afford to pledge? That's okay too. We really appreciate it if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone in your life who's curious about language.
Lingthusiasm is created and produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gawne. Our senior producer is Claire Gawne. Our editorial producer is Sarah Dopierella. Our production assistant is Martha Tsutsui Billings. And our production manager is Liz McCullough. Our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic.